welcome to the COVID Central. That's where it's going to die, not where it's going to live, okay? We're believing that God is touching the island very specially, and we're very, very grateful for the way that that's happening. But also, for all you who are listening, no matter where you are, because there's a few around about the place, we're believing also for freedom from COVID for you guys too, especially you in Melbourne. Our prayers are so much with you. So here we go. I have a title. Some people like titles, I personally don't, but I've got one here for you. It's called Free Fish. Yay, who likes free fish? Most people like free fish. Numbers 11, verses 4 to 9. Now, the mixed multitude, and this name here, the mixed multitude, has a really great Hebrew word for it. Hasafsuf. I like that. I've got to learn that one. Hasafsuf. And it occurs in the Hebrew Bible only here. Nowhere else in the entire Bible, just here. And it means riffraff or rabble. Now, some people think that the mixed multitude might have been foreigners amongst the Hebrews, but that is a different word. And so it's just here. Hasafsuf. All right. Now the mixed multitude who were among them craved more desirable foods. And so the Israelites wept again and said, if only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we used to eat freely in Egypt. The cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now we are dried up, and there is nothing at all before us except this manna. Now the manna was like coriander seed, and its color was like the color of bdellium. And the people went about and gathered it and ground it with mills or pounded it in mortars. They baked it in pans and made cakes of it, and it tasted like fresh olive oil. Yum. And when the dew came down on the camp in the night, the manna fell with it. Now, God sends a special gift food to feed his people, and they respond with moans and groans. Some years ago, a lady we knew was dying of emphysema. We spent time with her, and she gave her heart to the Lord. Then she died. The daughter was angry with God, angry with us, angry with everything. God didn't heal her. And we said, look, this lady spent most of her, your mum spent most of her life puffing away on cigarettes. She got emphysema and it killed her. But before she died, God brought her over. God saved her. She's in the arms of Jesus. What's wrong with that? Oh no, I think that God could have healed her. Yes, he could have, but he chose not to. And that's the way it is. But he saved the situation by bringing her through to him. I'd rather have a healing like that. I'd rather that Jesus captured my soul than me capture a healing anytime. Now, Exodus 24:17. Now, the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a consuming fire, yay, on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Now, some people regard this fire as a threat, even a sign of God's judgment, although it's probably better to regard it as a sign of God's passion. After all, the pillar of fire that had led the people out of bondage, just as it later dwelt between the cherubim on the Ark of the Covenant, the fire that fell on the followers of Jesus at Pentecost was the same manifestation of the glory of God's passionate love that was revealed at Sinai. Our God is a consuming fire. Which means that He's full of passion and zeal for you. You get that? He is full of passion for you. Now, He desires that your heart fully belongs to Him. The metaphor that God is a consuming fire suggests He is both indescribable and that He is passionately concerned with our devotion to Him. That this God who created and controls the universe desires a personal one-on-one relationship with you. That should leave us breathless. This same theme is carried into the New Testament as it should be. The new is in the old contained, the old is in the new explained. Hebrews 12, 28 and 29. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, and thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence on our with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire. Now, we are promised a kingdom that cannot be shaken, but we sometimes forget this when we are shaken. The fire that consumes will consume all things that are not established by our Heavenly Father. Deuteronomy 4, 39 and 40. Today, realize and carefully consider that the Lord is God, in heaven above and on earth below. There is no other. Keep His statutes and commandments that I am setting forth today, so that it may go well with you and your descendants, and that you may enjoy longevity in the land that the Lord your God is about to give you as a permanent possession. You want to live a long time? Behave yourself. That's the message. Bottom line. Our lives on the altar ascend to God in praise. The divine promise was, I will take you out from under the burdens of Egypt. Exodus 6 and verse 6. Later, the people romanticized their captivity and wanted to return there to eat their free fish. Numbers 11, 5. Do you know, it says they came under the burden of the Egyptians. But the word burden can also mean to bear something, to tolerate or carry something. And it's not too far a stretch to suggest that the people had tolerated their enslavement and made it work for them. Which leaves us likewise at risk of being enslaved by the sumptuous comforts and amenities offered by this world. Have we not tolerated our own slavery, our addictions to comfort, pleasures, a life of ease, the free fish, in other words? Are we really ready to leave all that we know behind to experience the glory of Zion? People may profess that they want to know God, that they hunger and thirst for righteousness, and earnestly desire that the kingdom of heaven be manifest, and yet they can't get away from their favorite television shows, gaming consoles, pop idols, and all the other fads of the day. We must be careful not to become comfortable in our exile, to become friends of this world, by losing faith's voice of protest. We must be careful not to be distracted from beholding spiritual reality and the ultimate healing to come. We are away from home. When the hour comes and we hear the sound of the shofar of the Lord calling us all to follow him home, we will be ready to leave the old ways behind. Or is it leeks and garlic on the menu? God chose to take the people along the longer road to the promised land, 40 years longer. We find ourselves still awaiting our redemption in the world to come. And like the Israelites, we must be on guard, since when things get difficult, our tendency is to go back to what is familiar, even if it's painful. Thank God we have a good shepherd who teaches us and guides us in the way to go. Isaiah 30, verse 20 and 21 says, "And though the Lord give you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet your teacher will not hide himself anymore, but your eyes shall see your teacher, your ears will hear a word behind you saying, 'This is the way, follow it,' when you turn to the right or to the left." Jesus is amongst us, everyone. Jesus is there for you to follow. Fail to follow at your peril. But what a great image of the Lord as our teacher and good shepherd, who guides us in the paths of life and delivers us from right and left hand errors. And so our prayer is, may God keep us on the path, free from the seductions of the tempter, who wants to distract our souls and lead us into fruitless byways and trouble. May we be given grace to see Jesus even in the midst of adversity or affliction, learning from him the way to go. Amen. Well, I trust you have a good week. Live for Jesus. You'll never be disappointed with him. God bless you. See you next week.